All right. Thank
Okay.
you for having us. Great to be part of the open source ecosystem. And I personally use a lot of open source tools in my developer days. And we continue to use a lot of open source at Axel as well. So, just a quick introduction. So, I'm a partner at Axel. I've been with Axel for the last 9 years. And Pranay, you want to do your introductions?
Hi guys. My name is Pranay. I'm a part of the investment team at Axel, along with Priyank. I've been at Axel for almost a year now. I've been a techie in the past, and then somehow landed magically into the VC land. That's been my journey so far.
So, just jumping quickly. So, just a quick introduction. So, Axel has been investing for now over 30 years and globally. We have essentially three offices, India, London, and Palo Alto. And in India, we've been investing for now over 10 years. But as you can see, we have a very large set of globally successful companies, which you can see on this list. But we particularly have a very strong affinity for open source businesses. And as you can see in the past, we have invested in a large number of companies. Some of these, for example, Snyk, you would have just heard about it. They raised a $200 million round last week, valued over $2 billion. And they started off as an open source project. And all of these companies which you see are open source companies, and all of them, like Segment, billion plus, Tenable billion plus. Cloudera billion plus, all of these, we have been lucky to partner with the founders very early on. And I hope today, in today's presentation, we can talk a little bit about, what do we see in the open source ecosystem. And so, what has happened really in the last 3 to 4 years in open source is it has got the fancy of enterprises. I mean, we as developers, like I was a developer back all the way back in 2004, and I used to use JBoss, and I used to use, I don't know if how many of you know, we used to contribute to SourceForge at that time. GitHub was still not there. We used to use Bitbucket and all other sorts of tools, and most of them were open source as well. And essentially, Linux, I think I worked on Linux kernel 3.0 or the like, and played around with it. And things have changed significantly since then. At that time, the biggest commercial company to come out of open source was Red Hat. But in the last 3 to 4 years, we've seen so many new companies which have come up and about, which are based on open source. That is just heartening to see. Just last week, JFrog has gone public as well. And there are a lot of other open source companies which are coming up on the in the IPO pipeline also. So we are pretty excited about open source businesses, commercially viable, creating a lot of value for entrepreneurs, investors, and the users as well. So that's where we are. Since it's a short presentation, I just wanted to focus on what have been our learnings once you are in open source. If you're an open source project, how do people make money? Where we have seen the value being created, I think you can sort it into essentially these three big buckets. So once the software has been adopted, and enterprise start using it or customers start using it, you could essentially provide support in either deploying the software. So sometimes, for example, big data solutions are essentially complex. Deploying them is hard. Understanding the nitty-gritty of it is hard. So you can help open source. You can create open source companies by giving help and deployment and maintaining these technologies by offering support. A good example of that would be, for example, Rasa, which is a open source. It's a open source project, uses open source components, libraries to build a chatbot AI system, and then on top of that provides support to enterprises when they want custom development, or when they want to understand how to optimize the chatbot library for their own benefit in a particular manner. So that's support. You could do hosting. So not everybody has on-prem, and a lot of companies benefit by providing a SaaS solution, which is managed by the open source creator of the project. So that is a big thing. And then obviously, you know, as you scale to enterprises, helping scale most open source projects initially when they start off small and have not seen production too much. But as you get into production, you want to be able to support scalability and extensibility across bare metal, across multi-cloud environments. And all of that requires expertise, and who best to provide that expertise than actually the creators of the software. And then finally, you have tooling, right? So not everybody works on CLI. People want a lot of time. Enterprises want team support. Enterprises want project management. A lot of companies would require you to have UI UX interfaces. And all of that is where your tooling comes in. Workflow tooling, as make a checker, how do you make sure that multiple people are on the same thing, essentially? And that, I think that's where GitHub and GitLab have actually made their name. And then finally, you have the core, essentially the freemium kind of offering in open source, where you give away a lot of the product for free, but the core of the product is for free, but then the platform is more proprietary and people pay for it. And these are just some examples of how each of these companies start into these broad themes, essentially. So that's a little bit about what we think. Pranay, you want to add anything here?
No, Pranay, I'm so elaborate.
And what do we look out for, right? So we as investors in all these platforms that we invested in, what do we look out for? I think there are some leading indicators and lagging indicators. Lagging indicators are easier to understand, much more objective, where once, if something has become successful, you could basically go back and say, hey, is there a community which has been built around it? So you could look at the GitHub stars. You could look at how much active their community is on Stack Overflow. Are people asking questions? Are people actually using them? What kind of questions are being asked? And then fundamentally also, people come back and claim to say, hey, Google is using me, Microsoft, Facebook is using me, Flipkart is using me, Urban Company is using me. I think those are essentially lagging indicators. It just tells you that the product has been successful. And yes, it is required when you go to raise funding at the later stages. But what are the leading indicators? And I think that is very important, because without the amount of money and time you invest and effort you invest in your open source project, you will not be able to become successful, right? So you start off, you have a few hundred users, and how does that blow up into that large multi-billion dollar company? I think it comes down to first is end user behavior, right? So what is the core of what you're trying to build, and how did it solve a particular problem, and what are the customers saying about it? And we go and speak to those customers. We speak to those, even if you have 10 customers or 20, 50 users, we'll try to speak to as many as we can, and we try to understand what is their behavior. Do they really love your product? Does it solve a pain point, or is it just a good to have? Can they, and the big thing is about consistency, right? So is everybody saying the same thing, or everybody is using it for different reasons? You might have made a very sophisticated platform with a lot of use cases built into it, but majority of customers will just use it for 10% of the code which you've written. And that's what we're trying to understand. What is everybody using it for? And I would recommend that just put on your product manager hat in these cases, and just try to also do this check with all your users, or just look at how much of the code being used every couple of months, if not every month. Second, I think is the project origin. I think there is a little bit of halo around projects which have come out of successful organizations, simply because it is felt that since it was part of a successful organization, it was already being used in production, that technology is a little bit tested, And it's a problem which is probably at scale, which is being solved. So there's already a need for this. And that kind of inspires early adoption among users as well. So there is sort of self-fulfilling prophecy that if it comes out of a respected organization, then there'll be more adoption and it'll become more, it'll accelerate in becoming larger and larger. And I think all the big data projects are a good example of that. Developer tools, however, are very different. Developer tools typically start off by the need of one single developer who really feels it has to be sorted out, it has to be fixed for him. And then, you know, he puts it up and everybody starts liking it, either be on Hacker Noon or Product Hunt or other places, right? And then finally, there's organic evangelism. I think this is really when you have a lot of customer love, a lot of people loving your product, people tweeting about it, people talking about it at forums, at meetups, presenting, hey, this is a new way of doing it. You'll start seeing a lot of influencers in your space talking about it. And I think that's where it starts becoming, the buzz starts going. We as developers tend to focus a lot more on, you know, building the product. But at some point of time, you build a great product, you need to market it a little bit, right? So there we need to put our hat on. We have to talk about it. We have to go speak at events. We have to go speak at developer events. We have to go speak at industry events. Why is this problem getting solved? And it's all grassroots. So that's also what we as investors look for. And this is all obviously within the gamut that we are looking to create a large company. So the market size, willingness to pay exists. People are willing, and you will be able to figure out a way in which to monetize your audience as well. And there have been great examples from India where, you know, even if the monetization is not there, since you have the community going, at some point of time, you could monetize that. And a good example of that, I think, is the Microsoft acquisition of GitHub, right? They acquired it because it just allowed them, and it was a pretty big acquisition, and it allowed them to access to a lot of developers, be the front and center to touch all the developers. And I think that's where you could also build out some of this. Pranay, you have anything to add here?
No, Frank.
Okay. So guys, that's really it from our side. I'll just this is me and Pranay, and would love, I don't know if we are taking questions or not. If we are, I'm happy to answer any questions, or maybe we have run out of time. I don't know.
One question came. Can you talk a bit about the revenue model of FOSS?
Yeah, so like I mentioned, if you go back to the three slides, to the slide which I was talking about, right? Yeah, I'm doing that. Yeah. So if you... Can you guys see the screen? So... typically, these are the six models in which you can make money from open source. The first one is support, within which there are two themes, like I said, deploying and easy to offer. The most common is obviously on the rightmost, right, which is limited open source. So you have a certain set of features which are open source, and then on top of that, you provide paid features, essentially. So these are the typical models. And a lot of these companies are public, so you could actually go to Elastic and, for example, and look at the investor presentation, how much users are paying them for their open side, for the free side, how many users are there on free and how many users on the paid. I hope that answers the question.
One point on the presentation. Could you share it again, please?
Sorry. Can you see it?
Yeah. So usually companies usually have a all over time. So we can start with something like help deploying some open source technologies. Then they go towards a hosting model and then eventually tooling around that part. So that's the gradual model that we have seen for a lot of these companies. They start by supporting, then hosting, and then finally limiting the open source and then, you know, allowing some tooling to be done done on top of it, some ancillary tooling to be done on top of it. The gradual flow in which companies evolve over time. But broadly speaking, as Priyank mentioned, there are three categories in which people monetize so far.
All right. So I think no other questions are there at the moment. I think we can now move on to the next talk. Thanks for the amazing talk. We will now
thanks, guys.
To the next talk in a few seconds. Goodbye.